My name's Chris and I'm an alcoholic. My sobriety date is Melbourne Cup Day 1995. This is a presentation of the fourth step taken from the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. It is a simple illustrated guide put together by two alcoholics.
Hi, my name's David. I'm an alcoholic. My sobriety date is the 25th of May 1993. This presentation is part of a series of presentations about covering all 12 steps. This one is particular about step four, but I just want to start by refreshing those first three steps and putting the fourth step into context. So step one, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives have become unmanageable. Step one is about understanding what my problem is. When I first came to AA, I'd been drinking for 17 years, and the last three of those years I'd been trying to stop drinking and failing and failing and failing. Multiple detoxes, hospitalizations. And I got to AA desperate, and I identified when people shared about their problem with drinking. The first thing I identified with is when people talked about the physical aspect of it, the physical craving. As an alcoholic, I don't drink like other people. Most people who drink, they get the effects of alcohol, the pleasant effect we're after, that idea that, you know, once I've had a couple of drinks, I can talk to other people more easily. But I get this extra effect that most people don't get, and it's actually an effect that I don't actually want. I get a craving for more and more. So after I had that first drink, I'd never want to stop at one or two, like most other people do. I'd want to keep going and keep going. And over time, that got worse. And I drank more and more and started making more and more mistakes, and I had to lie about it and cover it up, and I was breaking promises and hurting other people and ended up isolating. So when I heard people talk about this aspect of it, the physical craving, that when I drink it goes out of control, I identified, yep, that's me, I'm an alcoholic like that. So eventually in my drinking I got to a point where my life was falling apart, and I made a really sane decision. Well, I better stop drinking. And then I found I had this other part of the problem that AA talks about, this mental obsession. So even though I would stop drinking, and I'd have to get medical help to do that, to do a detox, but I'd stop drinking for a period of time, and life would get better when I stopped drinking because I'm showing up to work on time, I don't have to lie and cover things up, my health's improving. But at the same time, I have this mental obsession, this thought, this memory, this urge to go back and drink again. And I'd resist it, and I'd resist it. And then one day, I'd forget about all those bad things that were happening in my life when I was drinking and all the reasons why I decided to stop, and I would pick it up again. And when I picked it up again, it would set off the physical side again. I'd go quickly back to drinking the way I had been before, and all those problems would come rushing back into my life. And then once again, I'd make the decision that I'd stop, and then I would stop drinking for a period of time, but the mental obsession was there, leading me back to doing it again and again and again. So identifying with that problem is the first thing I needed to do when I came into AA. And I heard people share those same experiences, and I went, that's me. So that's my first step. But the thing about the first step is there's no hope in the first step. The first step doesn't solve my problem. That's just the realization I have a problem that I haven't been able to solve on my own. So if I'm powerless over alcohol, step two suggests that we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. So the thing about this step is that what I now need is an open mind. If everything that I've tried to do to stop drinking has failed, I need an open mind, open enough to listen to what's working for other people, even if they're suggesting something really radical, like a spiritual 12-step program, which is what this is. Nice thing about this step is that I get to choose my own conception of what this higher power is. AA doesn't try and tell me what to believe, but it does suggest I need to believe in something. But that thing is up to each individual person. And for me, this step comes from inspiration. I come to AA, I identify with the problem, and I meet people who've recovered. And for the first time in some time, I got some hope. I met people who'd actually had the same experience, but now they weren't drinking a day at a time. They were getting on with life, and lots of them were happy about not drinking. And I thought, maybe if that works for them, if this 12-step program works for them, maybe that can work for me. And that's my second step. So that then leads me to a decision. So step three, made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. And to me, that's a decision to try and live by spiritual principles. My spiritual principles, not being told to do what to do by other people, but trying to live up to what I know is right and wrong. And I've never tried to do that before, take a spiritual path in life. So to me, that third step is also a decision and a commitment to go on with the rest of the program. And the next few steps are a series of spiritual exercises that bring about a change in me, that remove the obstacles for me living a spiritual life. And where I really want to get to is the last three steps, because by the time I've got there, there's been a change in my way of living and thinking. I'm no longer obsessed with alcohol and I can get on with living life. And I need to continue to take some inventory on a daily basis, step 10, some prayer and meditation, step 11. And then the most important thing I need to do in order to stay sober long term is that 12th step and carrying the message to the next person. That's why we both do these presentations, is to carry this message that was passed to us. So step four is the one that lots of us balk at, and I balked at it for a little while as well. I've come to the realization I have this problem. Step one, I've got the hope in step two, I've made a decision in step three to go on with the process, but then I get some confusion about how do I go about taking this inventory. So step four, made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Now, when I got sober before there was a World Wide Web, but I was getting lots of different advice about doing this fourth step. These days, if you Google AA fourth step, you'll find lots and lots of information about a fourth step. I like to always refer back to this book. This book has the information. It was written when the first 100 members of AA got sober. So I like to refer to this book with its really specific instructions about how to take inventory. So, and that's what we'll be doing during this workshop, is taking the readings directly from the big book and showing how that informs us how to take inventory.
Therefore, we started upon a personal inventory. This was step four. A business which takes no regular inventory usually goes broke. Taking commercial inventory is a fact-finding and fact-facing process. It is an effort to discover the truth about the stock in trade. One object is to disclose damaged or unsaleable goods, to get rid of them promptly and without regret. If the owner of the business is to be successful, he cannot fool himself about values. We did exactly the same thing with our lives. We took stock honestly. First, we searched out the flaws in our makeup which caused our failure. Being convinced that self, manifested in various ways, was what had defeated us, we consider its common manifestations.
So this is a fact-finding and fact-facing process, an effort to discover the truth about ourselves. Now, the thing about stopping drinking, I'm an expert at stopping drinking because I did it over and over again. And whenever I stopped drinking, as I mentioned before, life tended to get better because my health's improving, I've got more money in my pocket, my relationships are improving because I'm not lying and covering things up and breaking promises. But at the same time, there's a whole lot of negative stuff going on in my head, a whole lot of guilt and remorse about the past and the people that I've hurt and the bridges that I've burnt. And a whole lot of fear about the future. What's going to happen if something goes wrong and I can't turn back to my old friend alcohol? And a whole lot of anger and resentment and blaming other people for my predicament. And I wouldn't be like this if he hadn't have sacked me or she hadn't have left me. So it's pretty hard to live a sober spiritual life if I've got all this negative thinking in my head. And remember, at this point, I've just made that decision in the third step to live a sober spiritual life. So this inventory for me is about having a look at those things and getting rid of enough of that negative thinking in order for me to get on with the spiritual program and get on with living a spiritual life. And the first thing it suggests we look at is this one.
Resentment is the number one offender. It destroys more alcoholics than anything else. From it stem all forms of spiritual disease. We've been not only mentally and physically ill, we have been spiritually sick. When the spiritual malady is overcome, we straighten out mentally and physically. In dealing with resentments, we set them on paper.
So the first thing it suggests we look at is resentments. I think this is a great place to start. First of all, because as it says, it's the number one offender. One of the biggest reasons for relapse is that I'm full of anger and resentment at the world. The other reason I think it's a great place to start is because it's a very easy place to start. The things and the people that I'm angry at come to mind really easily, particularly when I'm early in recovery. Now you'll notice as Chris reads through the big book, most of it on the screen is highlighted in yellow. And the parts in yellow sort of describe why we need to do it and what to expect as we go through that process. But in amongst that, you'll notice we've highlighted certain sentences, certain paragraphs in blue. These are the sentences which are the definite statements about this is what we did. Now remember, this is written by the first 100 members who got sober. And so what was said to me as I went through this process is whenever I come across a sentence that is a statement of this is what we did, then I should take that as an instruction and I should go ahead and do that thing too. So the first instruction is, in dealing with resentments, we set them on paper. So what do I need to do? Well, first of all, I need a piece of paper, okay, and a pen. And that's just how I start my fourth step, with a blank piece of paper and a pen. The other thing to remember is by this point in the program, I've probably got a sponsor. A sponsor is someone who is sober in the program and has been through this process themselves and can give me, guide me through this process because of their own experience. If I haven't got a sponsor at this point, good idea to get one, or at least someone who I can get some guidance from. The other thing to remember with this step, as with every step, is that this step is a spiritual exercise. So I can start this process with a prayer to whatever higher power I believe in. And the prayer can be a simple prayer based on the step itself. For example, God help me to be honest, fearless, and thorough. Okay, so now I'm sitting down, I've got my piece of paper and a pen, I've got someone I can call if I've got any questions or need some more guidance, and I've said that prayer to put myself in the right frame of mind, and what do I do next?
We listed people, institutions, or principles with whom we are angry.
So this is pretty simple. I'm going to make a list of people and things that I'm angry at. So I think of the person in the world I hate the most, and I write that person's name down on the piece of paper. And now I've started that fourth step. At this point, I can put that out of my mind, that first person's name out of my mind. I don't need to think too deeply about that or why that person came to mind. I just write down the name, put it aside for the moment, and think of another name. Who else am I angry at? So I've got my employer. I'll put down Mr. Brown, Mrs. Jones. She's my next door neighbor. Jack from the pub gives me the shits. Okay, I think back through time. I remember that high school science teacher back when I was 14 who embarrassed me in front of the class. I still remember how that felt. It could be people close to me, like my wife or my sister-in-law. It mightn't be an individual person, could be a group of people, say the police or the taxation department. It mightn't be a people at all. I can have a resentment against a principal. For example, I've got a resentment against, say, speed limits. Now, everyone else should obey the speed limits, but I'm a really good driver and I'm often late and I don't like getting fined, so I don't think they should apply to me. Sounds ridiculous when I say it out loud, but in my head, that's a real resentment. So I put that down, that principle. Or, for example, tax laws, I think, shouldn't apply to me. And I keep on thinking of names, adding them to my list, put down my mother, bad drivers, and I add to the list until I can't think of any more. Now, for some people, this is a really long list, and for other people, it's short. Now, I know one lady whose whole list was 8 people. These were the big resentments in her life. I know someone else who told me he had 280 people on his list. This is someone who'd worked all over the world and hated everyone he met. Okay, but 280 is pretty extreme. Whatever it is, however many people you have on your list, that's your list. And this, to me, shouldn't take very long. I sit down with a piece of paper, write out my list, perhaps sleep on it overnight and think if I missed anyone else, and now I have my starting point. And I can ring my sponsor and say, I now have my list of resentments. What do I do next?
We asked ourselves why we're angry.
Okay, so now we're going to look at each one of these. And I'm going to get an exercise book and rule it up like this. So the first column is who I'm resentful at, and the second column is going to be the cause. Now notice we're going to leave a whole lot of space over here on the right-hand side. We're going to leave that blank. We're going to need that later on. But to start with, we just have these two columns. And so one by one, I take the names off my list, doesn't really matter what order I do them in, as long as I do them all. Sometimes it's easier to take some of the older, less painful ones and do those first as just as an exercise. But I do know I've got to put every one of those people into my exercise book as we go. So I'll grab a name. I'll put down Mr. Brown. Now, what's the cause? What did he do to me that caused me to have this resentment against him? So, well, I don't like the way he pays attention to my wife. He told my wife about my mistress. That got me into lots of trouble. And Brown may get my job at the office. Now, you notice there, that's a simple description of what he did. I'm not trying to psychoanalyze him or write paragraphs and paragraphs about it or work out what his motives are. I'm just putting down the facts of what he did. In my head, it seems like three pages of things he's done, but when it comes to writing it down, that just ends up as three lines, 17 words about Mr. Brown. Once I've got those things down about Mr. Brown, I can cross him off my original list and pick out another name. So I put down Mrs. Jones. She's a nut. She snubbed me. She committed her husband for drinking and he's my friend. And she's a gossip. All good reasons not to like Mrs. Jones. Cross her off the list. Pick another name. So my employer is unreasonable, unjust, overbearing. And he's threatening to fire me for drinking and padding my expense account. Cross him off the list and I'll put down my wife, misunderstands and nags and likes Mr. Brown and wants to put the house in her name. Cross her off the list and I continue on taking these names, putting them into my exercise book and crossing off my original list until they're all in my book. Of course, if I've got more than a few, I'm going to need a second exercise book, but that's okay. They're pretty cheap at the supermarket. Once I've got them into my exercise book, I can throw that first piece of paper away. I don't need that anymore. And I can ring my sponsor and say, okay, I've now done the second column. What do I need to do next?
In most cases, it was found that our self-esteem, our pocketbooks, our ambitions, our personal relationships, including sex, were hurt or threatened. So we were sore. We were burned up. On our grudge list, we set opposite each name our injuries. Was it our self-esteem, our security, our ambitions, our personal sex relations, which had been interfered with?
So the next part is that we're going to look at how this other person's actions have affected us. And it's given us a bunch of key words to look for. Was it our self-esteem, our security, our ambitions, our personal or sex relations, which had been interfered with? So I go back to my list. Here's my new column, what part of me was affected. And I look at each one. So Mr. Brown, his attention to my wife. It's affected my sex relations with my wife. It's also affected my self-esteem because I'm worried that she likes him better than she likes me. And there's fear associated with that in regards to, she might want to run off with him. He told my wife about my mistress. Well, that's affected my sex relations and my self-esteem. I didn't want people to know about that secret. Brown may get my job at the office. Well, that's affected my security. That's money in my pocket, roof over my head type security. Because if he gets my job, I might be demoted or even out of a job. It's also affecting my self-esteem because I think the boss likes him better than he likes me. There's fear associated around the security aspect of that as well. Mrs. Jones, that affects my personal relationship, my self-esteem, and there's some fear involved with that. My employer, that's affected my self-esteem. Why does he like other people better than he likes me? It's also affecting my security because he's threatening to fire me. My wife, that's affected my pride, my personal and sex relations, and the part about wanting the house in her name is affecting my security. Yeah, so this is a simple process of going through the list, looking at each one of them and working out what part of me was affected and seeing which key words apply in each of those situations. See, the first two columns, there's no new information. It's stuff I already know. I know who it was that hurt me, and I know what they did to hurt me. But in the end, I want to learn something new about myself. So this column, I think it's really valuable because it starts to shift the focus away from that other person and onto me. Now, I just want to point out that this example is straight out of the AA Big Book on page 65. So Mr. Brown, Mrs. Jones, the employer and the wife. This is not my inventory. I wouldn't put my inventory up on a screen and make it available to lots of other people. This is a very private thing, this fourth step. It's between me and a piece of paper and my higher power and nobody else at this point. This example is out of the book. Now, the book doesn't take the example any further than that third column. So from here on in, what we're going to show you is sort of our best guess about what this guy in the book would have put into the rest of his inventory.
We went back through our lives. Nothing counted but thoroughness and honesty. When we were finished, we considered it carefully. The first thing apparent was that this world and its people were often quite wrong. To conclude that others were wrong was as far as most of us ever got. The usual outcome was that people continued to wrong us and we stayed sore. Sometimes it was remorse and then we were sore at ourselves. But the more we fought and tried to have our own way, the worse matters got. As in war, the victor only seemed to win. Our moments of triumph were short-lived. It is plain that a life which includes deep resentment leads only to futility and unhappiness. To the precise extent that we permit these, do we squander the hours that might have been worthwhile. But with the alcoholic, whose hope is the maintenance and growth of a spiritual experience, this business of resentment is infinitely grave. We found that it is fatal, for when harbouring such feelings, we shut ourselves off from the sunlight of the spirit, the insanity of alcohol returns and we drink again. And with us, to drink is to die. If we were to live, we had to be free of anger. The grouch and the brainstorm were not for us. They may be the dubious luxury of normal men, but for alcoholics, these things are poison.
So this is pointing out how dangerous resentments are. It's also pointing out that it's not just alcoholics who get resentments and are angry, but any life lived full of resentment and anger is going to be a pretty horrible life. And for us, it's even worse. Because if I stay angry and stay in resentment, it's going to lead me to pick up a drink again. So what's a resentment? A resentment is I start thinking about a person that I know, and when I start thinking about that person, I start to remember all the nasty things that that person did to me, which is what my second column is about. And then I start to re-feel that hurt from the past. I think to myself, that person hurt me, which is what that third column is about. Resentment is re-feeling that hurt from the past. And what normally happens then is my next thought, well, is this guy's a bastard, this guy in the first column. And I think about all those nasty things he did to me. I run through that list of things again, and then I re-feel that hurt, which is that third column. And I think to myself, well, this guy's a bastard, isn't he? And he did all those nasty things to me, and it hurt me, the bastard. And round and round and round it goes in my head. And the longer I think about it, the worse he gets. He's just this nasty person that's picking on me. And the more innocent I get, I didn't do anything wrong. And then I start thinking about what I could have done differently. When he said that to me, I should have said this or this or this. This is what I should have said to him. And then I start praying he gets hit by a bus. And then I start thinking about the next time. The next time that he's critical of me, I'm going to actually point out what all his problems are. And this goes round and round in my head. And I'm lying awake at night thinking about this stuff. He's at home sleeping peacefully, not thinking about me at all. And then in amongst this might go on for some time, this negative thinking, all I can think about. And then all of a sudden, this really pleasant thought comes into my head. Look, if I have a couple of drinks, I'll be able to forget about him for the night. So I go ahead and have those couple of drinks. And of course, now I'm an alcoholic. So when I have those couple of drinks, I don't stop at one or two. It goes out of control. Next day, I'm late for work and I'm hungover and all my problems have had puppies. So I need to get past these resentments. Now, at this point, while I'm doing a fourth step, I need to get past this resentment long enough to actually find out something about myself. So how do I do that?
We turn back to the list, for it held the key to the future. We were prepared to look at it from an entirely different angle. We began to see that the world and its people really dominated us. In that state, the wrongdoing of others, fancied or real, had power to actually kill. How could we escape? We saw that these resentments must be mastered, but how? We could not wish them away any more than alcohol. This was our course. We realized that the people who wronged us were perhaps spiritually sick. Though we did not like their symptoms and the way these disturbed us, they, like ourselves, were sick too. We asked God to help us show them the same tolerance, pity, and patience that we would cheerfully grant a sick friend. When a person offended, we said to ourselves, "This is a sick man. How can I be helpful to him? God save me from being angry, thy will be done. We avoid retaliation or argument. We wouldn't treat sick people that way. If we do, we destroy our chance of being helpful. We cannot be helpful to all people, but at least God will show us how to take a kindly and tolerant view of each and every one.
So I suggest we turn back to the list, and this time I'm going to try and take a different attitude to that person. And then it suggests we're going to ask God something. We're going to ask our higher power something. So how do we do that? Well, it's actually suggesting that we say a prayer. So at this point, I can put down the pen. I don't need to write anything down, but I go back through the list one by one, and I think about each person, and I say a prayer. So I think about Mr. Brown. God save me from being angry. How can I be helpful to him? And I think about Mrs. Jones. God save me from being angry. How can I be helpful to her? And I think about my employer. And perhaps through gritted teeth, reluctantly, God save me from being angry at the bastard. I do it anyway, it's a spiritual exercise. I go ahead and do that anyway. And I think about my wife. God save me from being angry. How can I be helpful to her? So this column is a reminder once again that this is a spiritual exercise. Okay, I'm trying to bring about a change in me through these series of spiritual exercises. It's interesting, as sometimes in that, as we're writing that second column down, we look at those resentments, I write it down, I read it back to myself, and some of them are just so petty and ridiculous. Just that process of writing it down and reading it back, and the resentment just disappears all by itself almost. Some of them are a bit tougher than that, and it's when I say this prayer that that resentment starts to lift. Some might be even tougher still, and I might have some justification for it. So even saying this prayer isn't going to lift this resentment. But remember, this is just the fourth step. This is just the beginning of the house cleaning steps. Some of those resentments might require the rest of the house cleaning steps. Step 4, step 5, step 6, step 7, steps 8, and steps 9 to lift those really heavy ones. But at least we've made a start on this spiritual progress. So once I've said that, I've done that, I've said a prayer for everyone on my list, I ring my sponsor and say, okay, I've done that, what do I do next?
Referring to our list again, putting out of our minds the wrongs others had done, we resolutely look for our own mistakes. Where had we been selfish, dishonest, self-seeking and frightened? Though a situation had not been entirely our fault, we tried to disregard the other person involved entirely. Where were we to blame? The inventory was ours, not the other man's. When we saw our faults, we listed them. We placed them before us in black and white. We admitted our wrongs honestly and were willing to set these matters straight.
So we go back through the list again. And this time, I'm going to look for something that I'd never looked for before. I'm going to look for my mistakes. In fact, there's actually two things I'm looking for here. My mistake, what did I do or fail to do that contributes to this resentment? And the second thing is my fault, which is sort of like the underlying defect of character. And once again, it's given us a bunch of key words to look for. Where have we been selfish, dishonest, self-seeking and frightened? So I go back through my list and look at each one. Mr. Brown, his attention to my wife. What's my mistake? Well, I've been neglecting my wife. And I'll give it a label. Okay, I'm being selfish. Now, it could be that Mr. Brown's a bit of a sleazy guy and he's doing the wrong thing. He's trying to move in on the wife. But I'm trying to put that out of my mind and work out what my mistake is. And I'm down the pub all the time getting drunk. And that's what's given him the opportunity. On the other hand, it could all be in my head. You know, he's actually just a nice guy. Occasionally has a cup of coffee with my wife because she's lonely because I'm down the pub all the time. But either way, I'm looking for my mistake, and that's the point. I've been neglecting my wife and being selfish. He told my wife about my mistress. What's my mistake? Well, that one's really obvious. I was unfaithful, being dishonest. Brown may get my job at the office. My mistake? Well, I was looking after my own interests rather than doing my job properly, being self-seeking. Mrs. Jones, she's a nut. She snubbed me. What's my mistake? Well, I was inconsiderate to her. You know, she's my next door neighbour. I've come home late at night one night drunk, singing at the top of my voice, slamming car doors, woke her up at 3 o'clock in the morning. The next day I saw her in the street and I waved at her, "Hi, Mrs. Jones," and she didn't wave back at me, the cow. You know, I'll have a resentment against her for a couple of weeks over that, just because she didn't acknowledge me in the street. But when I think about it, well, it's because I was inconsiderate to her the night before. so I was being selfish. She committed her husband for drinking and he's my friend. Now, what's that got to do with me? Surely that's between her and her husband. Well, I'm afraid that might happen to me. So it's my fear of that happening to me is being triggered by Mrs. Jones's actions. So I'm frightened. And she's a gossip. Well, maybe she is the nasty neighbourhood gossip and she's telling tales all over the place. What's my mistake? Well, I've done things I don't want other people to know about. If I hadn't have done those things that I'm ashamed of, I wouldn't be worried about her gossiping about me. So I'm being dishonest. My employer, unreasonable, unjust, overbearing. Well, I was unreliable, being selfish. He's threatening to fire me for drinking and padding my expense account. My mistake? Well, I was actually doing the things that he's accusing me of. I was drinking on the job and stealing. It's interesting. Now, I'm doing the wrong thing, right? And he's calling me out on it. I'm getting resentment against him for calling me out, for me doing the wrong thing. So I'm being dishonest. My wife misunderstands and nags and likes Brown. Well, I don't pay any attention to her, being selfish. Wants to put the house in her name. Well, I put my job in jeopardy by drinking and stealing. So she's just looking after her own security there. So once again, being dishonest. So I go through my list, and this becomes very interesting to me because I start seeing a whole lot of patterns in the way that I've been behaving towards other people and reacting to the way they behave towards me. And it's a new way of looking at myself. Now, you notice as we went through this process of the resentments, we started out by making the first list. We didn't go on to the second column until we had a complete list of names. Once we did that, we wrote down the names and wrote down the column with the cause of what caused that resentment. We didn't start on the third column until we finished the second column. Then we went down the page and worked out what part of me was affected. Then we went down the page and said a prayer for each person. And then finally, we go down the page and work out what my mistake is. Now, the reason we really emphasize going down the page, down the page, down the page is that AA's experience is this is the best way of doing it for a couple of reasons. One is for sometimes people can get stuck on a particular resentment if they go across the page. You get to one particular resentment, really hurtful resentment, and I got stuck either in the second column when I think about what that other person did, or I get stuck on that third, on that last column when I start to think about, you know, how I'd been treating those other people. The other reason I think it's a great way of doing it, of going down the page, is that by the time I get to that fourth column, I can really start seeing the patterns in my behavior. There it is again. There's my reaction to my boss, which is the same as the reaction to that high school teacher, which is the same as the reaction with any authority figure or for example. There's that repeated behavior, and I can clearly see it because I'm just looking at my behavior and not the other person's behavior when I'm looking at that fourth column. So that's my resentment list, and that's just the first part of this inventory. So the next part is about fear.
Notice that the word fear is bracketed alongside the difficulties with Mr. Brown, Mrs. Jones, the employer, and the wife. This short word somehow touches about every aspect of our lives. It was an evil and corroding thread. The fabric of our existence was shot through with it. It set in motion trains of circumstances which brought us misfortune we felt we didn't deserve. But did not we ourselves set the ball rolling? Sometimes we think fear ought to be classed with stealing. It seems to cause more trouble. We reviewed our fears thoroughly. We put them on paper, even though we had no resentment in connection with them.
So once again, it says these things need to go on paper. So what do I need? I need a list of my fears. This is my next list, a list of fears. Where do I get this list from? Well, I can actually refer back to my resentment list because I've already identified a whole lot of fear here and here and here through that fears list. And what I can do now is take each one of those and give them a name and put them on my new list. So there's a fear that my wife will leave. There's a fear of being lonely if the wife leaves and I lose the mistress as well. There's a fear of failure. There's a fear that people will find out about the things that I've done. There's a fear of confrontation with my boss and probably other people on my resentment list. There's a fear of financial insecurity. So I can get those things down. That's sort of the seeds for my new list of fears. And then I can think, are there any other fears that I have that aren't necessarily related to resentments? And I can add those to the end. So I've got a fear of meeting new people, and, say, a fear of success. So I've got a fear of failure and I've got a fear of success, so I'm pretty well screwed either way now. Okay, I've got this list of fears, and once again, for some people it's a long list and for other people it's short. You know, some people are, some people in AA who are really angry people, lots and lots of resentments and not so many fears, and other people, not so many resentments, and they're absolutely full of fear. There's no such thing as an alcoholic personality. There's all sorts of people in AA, all sorts of people with an alcohol problem. But the great thing about this step, this fourth step, and the way that it's laid out in the big book, is that it tailors the rest of the house cleaning steps specifically to me. You know, we've all lived different lives, come from different backgrounds, had different experiences, and this fourth step brings out the things I need to look at, because my fourth step is different from your fourth step, is different from his fourth step, is different from her fourth step. It tailors the rest of the program. The process is the same for everyone, but the details, the particulars, are different. Okay, and so this is what sets me up for my fifth step, and my sixth step, and my seventh step, and my eighth step, and my ninth step. So now I have a list of fears, and what do I do with that?
We asked ourselves why we had them. Wasn't it because self-reliance failed us? Self-reliance was good as far as it went, but it didn't go far enough. Some of us once had great self-confidence, but it didn't fully solve the fear problem or any other. When it made us cocky, it was worse.
We ask ourselves why we had these fears. I go back to the list and ask this question: why do I have this fear? How did I set the ball rolling? This column is really similar to the last column of the resentment list. I'm looking for my mistakes. So there's that fear that my wife will leave. Well, I've been neglecting my wife. My selfishness has screwed up relationships in the past. That's why I'm worried I end up with no one. I give up before the job is done. I've hurt people and stolen stuff. I don't stand up for my principles. I've been reckless. I have prejudices. I try to be self-reliant rather than trusting in my higher power. Once I've put something down for each of those fears, then what do?
Perhaps there is a better way. We think so. For we are now on a different basis, the basis of trusting and relying upon God. We trust infinite God rather than our finite selves. We're in the world to play the role he assigns, just to the extent that we do as we think he would have us and humbly rely on him. Does he enable us to match calamity with serenity? We never apologize to anyone for depending upon our Creator. We can laugh at those who think spirituality the way of weakness. Paradoxically, it is the way of strength. The verdict of the ages is that faith means courage. All men of faith have courage. They trust their God. We never apologize for God. Instead, we let him demonstrate through us what he can do. We ask him to remove our fear and direct our attention to what he would have us be. At once, we commence to outgrow fear.
There's a little promise in there. This is the beginning of outgrowing fear. And the instruction? The instruction is we're going to ask our higher power something again. So the instruction is to say a prayer. Now, the thing about this prayer is that there's two parts of the prayer. We ask God to remove the fear and then show us what he would have us be. So this is something I can think about. It doesn't specifically say I need to write it down, but it's certainly something I can think about, and I might want to write it down as well. So I look at each one and say that prayer and say, well, my higher power wants me to be faithful, wants me to be loving, wants me to be hopeful, wants me to be honest, wants me to be courageous, wants me to be responsible, wants me to be compassionate, and wants me to be humble. So this column can be a really uplifting exercise. I'm looking at the future in a different way. You know, when we looked at those resentments are all about the past. That's what the resentments are. They're things that happened in the past that are still affecting me. Fear is always about the future. Fear is what I'm worried is going to happen in the future. Now remember, at this point in the program, I've just made this decision in the third step to take a different path in life, to try and live a sober spiritual life. So what would that be like? What sort of qualities do I want in my life? Does my higher power want me to have in my life? So this is this uplifting exercise. Sometimes we think of a four-step as being a really negative exercise. In a lot of ways it is, because I'm looking at negative things from the past, but it also can be a really uplifting exercise when I look to the future in a different way. These are the spiritual qualities that I now want to bring into my life.
Now about sex. Many of us needed an overhauling there, but above all, we try to be sensible on this question. It's so easy to get way off the track. Here we find human opinions running to extremes, absurd extremes perhaps. One set of voices cry that sex is a lust of our lower nature, a base necessity of procreation. Then we have the voices who cry for sex and more sex, who bewail the institution of marriage, who think that most of the troubles of the race are traceable to sex causes. They think we do not have enough of it, or that it isn't the right kind. They see its significance everywhere. One school would allow man no flavour for his fare, and the other would have us all on a straight pepper diet. We want to stay out of this controversy. We do not want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct. We all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. What can we do about them? We reviewed our own conduct over the years past. Where had we been selfish, dishonest, or inconsiderate? Whom had we hurt? Did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? Where were we at fault? What should we have done instead? We got this all down on paper and looked at it.
So the next thing it suggests we look at is our intimate relationships. Now, we know that intimate relationships are the source of some of the greatest joy in our lives, but when they go wrong, some of the greatest pain. So I can learn a lot about myself by looking at these things. Now, it goes to great lengths to point out that AA isn't trying to be the arbiter or the judge of this. You know, this whole fourth step is not about what other people think. It's not my sponsor or AA or my priest or my mother or anybody else. It's about the fourth step is between me and a piece of paper and my higher power and nobody else. It does say that it's a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. And to me, that means, that word moral means that I need to make an assessment of my own behaviour based on my own values so I can learn something about myself. So I'm going to need a new list, a list of relationships. And we'll just make this one up for the guy that's in the book. This, once again, this is not my personal inventory. I'm making this up for the guy that's in the book. Okay. So I'll put down my first girlfriend, Barry's girlfriend, that fling in 1994, my wife, and my mistress. Now, I've got my list. Once again, for some people it's a long list, and for other people it's short. For some people it's alarmingly long, for other people it's disappointingly short. But it's our own list. So, for each person on the list, there's a bunch of questions that it suggests I ask myself. Who did I hurt? Did I arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? Where was I selfish, dishonest, or inconsiderate? I'm looking for those three key words. Where was I at fault, and what should I have done instead? So I look at each one and think about that first girlfriend. What caused all the arguments and the eventual breakup of that relationship? Well, I threatened to dump her if she didn't have sex more often. That was the big issue in that relationship. So I'll give it a label. Okay, I was being selfish. One of the questions there is, what should I have done instead? And I can think about that and say, well, I should have respected her wishes. Barry's girlfriend flirted with her, caused jealousy, hurt Barry as well. Give it a label. Okay, I was being inconsiderate. What could I have done differently? Well, I should have considered their relationship. That fling in 1994, don't even remember her name. Well, I lied to her about my intentions. I'm being dishonest. So why was I lying? Probably to get something out of the relationship. Who knows? Even if I had have been honest, it might have happened anyway. So I should have been honest with her. Now, the wife, now not all relationships end up badly. If you've got a relationship that's fine and dandy and everything's going well and lovingly, that's great. You know, write that down. But given that alcoholism gets in the way of that, alcoholism causes me to be dishonest and break promises and let people down and hurt people, it's not likely that all our relationships are rosy. This one started out great but ended up being inconsiderate and unfaithful, caused suspicion and bitterness. So give it a label. Okay, I was selfish and I was inconsiderate and I was dishonest. I got all three labels with that one. Once again, what could I have done differently based on my values, on the way I think I should have behaved? Well, I should have spent more time with her, should have listened to her, should have been faithful. The mistress, I lied to her about being married, so I'm being dishonest. Yeah, I probably shouldn't have started that relationship in the first place. So once again, when looking at these relationships, we're looking at the past. We've looked at the past and see how we've hurt other people. And now, once again, we want to look to the future.
In this way, we tried to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life. We subjected each relation to this test. Was it selfish or not? We asked God to mold our ideals and help us to live up to them. We remembered always that our sex powers were God-given and therefore good, neither to be used lightly or selfishly, nor to be despised and loathed. Whatever our ideal turns out to be, we must be willing to grow toward it. We must be willing to make amends where we have done harm, provided that we do not bring about still more harm in so doing. In other words, we treat sex as we would any other problem. In meditation, we ask God what we should do about each specific matter. The right answer will come if we want it.
From that list, from that inventory of our sex conduct, we're going to try and shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life. And I should write this down. So this is the ideal for the future, and it suggests that I say a prayer about it. Now, what goes down here can be quite specific to each individual person, depending on their experience and their circumstances. So, for example, a middle-aged married guy who wants to rebuild his marriage might put down certain specific things about this, which might be a bit different from a young single woman who has some ideas about some short-term relationships but other ideas about longer-term ones, which would be quite different from, say, a nun. I mean, there are nuns and priests in AA. A nun might just put down, continue with my celibacy, I'm doing a great job. Okay, so this is really specific to each person. I'm not going to give a specific example here, but I can think about it, and having looked at that inventory and the way that I've hurt other people and hurt relationships, I can say, well, my higher power wants me to be honest, wants me to be considerate of the other person or people, wants me to be dependable, wants me to be selfless, and above all, wants me to be loving. So once again, there's this uplifting exercise as part of the fourth step. I've looked at the damage and the hurt from the past, and now because I've just made that third step decision and decided to live a spiritual life, what sort of qualities do I want to bring? What sort of qualities does my higher power want me to bring, either to repair broken relationships or into new relationships as they form?
God alone can judge our sex situation. Counsel with persons is often desirable, but we let God be the final judge. We realize that some people are as fanatical about sex as others are loose. We avoid hysterical thinking or advice. Suppose we fall short of the chosen ideal and stumble. Does this mean we are going to get drunk? Some people tell us so. But this is only a half-truth. It depends on us and on our motives. If we are sorry for what we have done and have the honest desire to let God take us to better things, we believe we will be forgiven and will have learned our lesson. If we are not sorry and our conduct continues to harm others, we are quite sure to drink. We are not theorizing. These are facts out of our experience. To sum up about sex, we earnestly pray for the right ideal, for guidance in each questionable situation, for sanity, and for the strength to do the right thing. If sex is very troublesome, we throw ourselves the harder into helping others. We think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. It quiets the imperious urge when to yield would mean heartache.
So that's great advice for the future and living a sober spiritual life. Now, there's one more list we need.
If we have been thorough about our personal inventory, we have written down a lot. We've listed and analysed our resentments. We've begun to comprehend their fertility and their fatality. We've commenced to see their terrible destructiveness. We have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill toward all men, even our enemies, for we look on them as sick people. We have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can.
Okay, so the last list I need is the people that I've harmed. When I get to step 8, it says in the book, I have a list of people we have harmed. We made it when we took inventory. So I want to make sure we do have this list at this point. Where do I get this list from? Well, I can go back through my previous lists. and pick out some people. So Mrs. Jones and the harm done while I was inconsiderate to her. My employer, I stole from him. My wife, I neglected her, made her worry about security. So notice I'm not going to put Mr. Brown on this list. When I look at what's happened there with Mr. Brown, I can see what he's done that caused that resentment, but I haven't actually done anything to hurt him. So he doesn't need to go on my harms done list. Once I've got those things down from there, I can look at my other lists. Okay, maybe from the fears list will remind me of some other people. My sister-in-law stole money from her purse. My relationship list, lots of people I can put on my harms done list there. So there's that first girlfriend, Barry's girlfriend and Barry. There's the girl from 1994 and the mistress. And then I can think, is there anyone else that I've harmed that didn't come up on my resentments or my fears or my relationship list? And add those to the end. So I put down the hotel in Sydney. I left without paying the bill, so I've stolen from them. There's my brother. I borrowed his watch without him knowing it when I was, you know, 7 years old, and I broke it and I put it back and I didn't own up. It was me that broke it. Now, at one level, who really cares? It's all those years ago. It was a $10 watch. What does it matter? But for some of us, that little secret thing that we've kept hidden, particularly when it involves someone close to us, someone we love, that's this guilty thing. You know, it's fact-finding, fact-facing. I need to put that one down as well. There's that ex-work colleague. I blamed him for stealing stationery and got him fired. Now, I've affected that guy in a big way. Not only has he lost his job, but I've actually hurt his reputation. When it comes to steps 8 and 9, I'm going to really have to think about what to do about that. But at the moment, all I'm doing is just writing it down, fact-finding, fact-facing, putting down the facts. So there's my list, my four lists: resentments, fears, sex conduct, and the harms done.
In this book, you read again and again that faith did for us what we could not do for ourselves. We hope you are convinced now that God can remove whatever self-will has blocked you off from Him. If you have already made a decision and an inventory of your grosser handicaps, you've made a good beginning. That being so, you have swallowed and digested some big chunks of truth about yourself.
This is the beginning of the house cleaning steps, but it is only a beginning, and it's a big beginning. So I remember having my fourth step. I ended up, as I was saying, 3 years of trying to stop drinking and failing, multiple detoxes, hospitalizations. I ended up in a longer-term rehab, a three-month rehab, more like a dry house, really. Six guys living in a three-bedroom house, a couple of staff there during the day, a bit of a program, but we're expected to go to AA meetings every night. And that's where I got some hope, by going to those meetings, you know, meeting people who'd recovered with this program. Now, I knew when I left that rehab that I was going to drink again. I didn't want to, but I knew that's what always happened. Left to my own devices, I'd pick up a drink again, and when I drink, it goes out of control. So I got the hope from AA and got past the hesitation I had about the spiritual aspect of the program and decided that this is what I needed to do to go on. I bought for a little bit, not for very long, on this fourth step. At the same time in the house, the other five guys, one of them finished his 3 months and left. The other four guys all relapsed and were thrown out. I didn't want that to happen to me. So the best thing I could do at that point was to sit down at the kitchen table, and this is what I did. I sat at that kitchen table by myself for a couple of days and took this inventory. I can remember actually finishing it and having my exercise book in my hands. One of the other books, the 12 and 12, talks about this is the first tangible evidence of our complete willingness to move on. To me, this was a huge achievement to actually have completed the fourth step. It was more important to me than actually learning something about myself. This idea that I'd actually surrendered, I'm actually capable of enough surrender in order to do this, to do something that I don't really want to do, but I know that the program and my higher power was suggesting that I needed to do in order to move on. So remember, this fourth step is a spiritual exercise. It's not an intellectual exercise or a psychological exercise. It's a spiritual exercise. So I need to be honest and I need to be fearless. Now, I'm not particularly honest and I'm not particularly fearless. In fact, as I go through this process, I find out a lot more about how dishonest and full of fear I really am. But that's why I need those first three steps before I get to this point. I need to be convinced that I'm powerless over alcohol. I get that hope in step two and then make that commitment to living a spiritual life in step three. The other thing is that it needs to be thorough. And when we're talking about being thorough, to me that means don't leave anything out. There's a temptation to write paragraphs and paragraphs and write a whole lot of stuff, add stuff in that's sometimes not necessary. To be thorough, I need to make sure that I don't leave anything out of the first column of each of those lists. If I leave something out, some fear, some resentment, some harm I've done to someone else, I think that one I can leave aside. That's the one that's likely to trip me up in the future. And the other thing is to keep it simple. There's a great temptation to make this process of the fourth step much more complicated than it needs to be. I like this way it's described in the big book. It's about making a list and saying a prayer and looking at myself. And making a list and saying a prayer and looking at myself. See, I don't think I could write a novel about myself, right? Write a narrative about my life. But I can make a list. It's that simple. So thanks for letting us share.
Thank you for listening. You can contact us through our website, illustratedsteps.org.